So now let's turn from the company itself, and as we saw, one way to remove the power of the company to enter into a contract would be to restrict its objects. But that avenue has been taken away in Hong Kong by Section 116, which now allows the contract to be enforceable, although also allows shareholders to sue directors for any damages resulting if they were to enter into a contract that violates the company's object. So let's look directly at management now. The ordinance conveys certain powers on the members, and this power cannot be exercised by the board alone. The articles can limit the power of the company or also of the directors. And then a shareholder's resolution, such as, for example, to allot shares, can also set limits on the power conveyed on the directors. For a manager or a lower level employee, we might simply have a power of attorney, and powers of attorney can be general or specific and can be limited in many ways. So we have a number of places where we can see restrictions on the power of agents acting for the company. A confusing thing in the company, however, is that we have this internal administrative activity, such as passing resolutions, and the outside world doesn't always see it. In the case of Turcand, the British case of Turcand, a rule was made that if the resolution internally was necessary in order to give the agent power, the third person may assume that the internal management of the company was done in accordance with necessary procedures, unless that third person is put on inquiry notice, sees something quite strange about this, sees, for example, that the transaction benefits the actor, the director, but does not benefit the company itself. Or it's the kind of a transaction that is normally not entered into by one or even two directors on behalf of the company. So, where there's something unusual, the third party should take the time to inquire and investigate. However, where the transaction is normal, that would not be necessary. This is the rule in Turcand, and it is a rule of apparent authority, and it is referred to sometimes as an indoor management rule, although you'll see in the Thai Chamcat case, the court distinguishes Turcand and apparent authority from the indoor management rule. So contracts made by the company's directors have been also regulated by Section 117 of the company's ordinance in a relatively unusual way. So it's a very strong statement that we see in Section 117. The power of the company's directors to bind the company or authorize others to do so is to be regarded free of limitation. Free of limitation, no limitation whatsoever. And the person who's dealing with the agent does not have to inquire about whether the person has authority. And if the third person sees the articles of association, and the articles do limit the agent's power, that still will not remove the good faith trust of the third person that the agent has authority to act on behalf of the company. This is an unusual section. We'll discuss this in class. Please do think about it. The reason I'm giving it to you, I could give you an easy reading and a solution of this, but I'd like for you to work through it a bit, not as much to become a master of apparent authority, but more so to begin cutting your teeth on statutory interpretation. Company law is a very statutory area of the law. That's why I ask you to purchase a photocopied version of the ordinance. And we'll be working with the ordinance a lot. I don't think you've done this so far in other courses. Perhaps in civil procedure, you spent quite a bit of time with rules. Similar to that course, we'll be spending a lot of time with an ordinance. And when you're working as a lawyer, you will spend a lot of time with ordinance as well. So that's why I'm asking you to move away from textbooks and start looking at the law itself. And so please do spend some time thinking about 117 and try to understand what it means. And I give you here in this slide some ways that 117 can be read. When we say the company's directors, that could mean each individual director of the company, or it could mean the company's directors acting as a unit, as a group, that is the board. And that will change what the section means. So please do take a look at this slide, think about it, and form your own understanding of the breadth of Section 117 for ordinary dealings by the company in relationship to third persons. In Pacific Foundation Finance, we've got a very strange case. All right, so John Chan is an owner of one company, which is the owner of another company in which John Chan is a director. That itself is not unusual. It's not unusual for one physical person to own a couple of different companies that themselves are related. If you look at Hutchinson, for example, you have about 300 different companies that are related in the group, and that is not terribly unusual. Okay? What's unusual here is there was a bit of tricky dealing going on where we have a loan between Anklong and Ferion for $108 million, not an insignificant sum. And then Ferion borrows money from Pacific Foundation and asks for that those funds to be paid directly to Anklong, which partially relieves its debt to Anklong. So now Ferion owes Pacific Foundation $25 million, but it only owes Anklong $82 million, because the 108 has been reduced by 25 or 83 million. Okay, that in itself is not terribly strange. The next step is strange. So because John Chan is the owner of Anklong and a director of Ferion, what the argument that Ferion makes is that John Chan was self-interested in approving the loan from Pacific Foundation, and therefore the loan agreement itself was invalid because the board of Ferion did not approve this properly, given that John Chan had a conflict of interest and John Chan did not follow the procedure that would be necessary in order to cleanse that conflict of interest by not providing notice to the rest of the board and having the board simply agree that, yes, we will allow you to vote on this, even though you do have a self-interest, given that the funds will be paid to Anklong and you are the owner of Anklong. You can see how this is strange, right? Now, John Chan would be the beneficiary of the contract with Pacific Foundation being declared invalid because he is also a director of Ferion. So he's using his own conflict of interest to benefit himself. So what the court does, Justice Anselmo Reyes in his decision does, is to look at this notion that Fair Young's board did not receive notice of John Chan's conflict and point out that Fair Young has been declaring in its annual reports for a number of years that it owed money to Anklung. And everyone knew clearly, and it had been declared in writing, that John Chan, director of Fair Young, was the owner of Anklung. So there was plenty of notice. The notice was so obvious and so clear and so repeated that it need not be made again expressly at the time that the Pacific Foundation loan was agreed. And so therefore the board did approve John Chan's participation and vote, and the vote was valid, and the loan is valid, and therefore Fair Young does owe Pacific Foundation the $25 million. Case is a bit convoluted, but it gives you an idea of how this notion of power and lacking power can be used for fraud, and also it shows you in the initial steps of the argument, how it's important that the internal management is done properly in order to give the agents power to bind the company.